Good evening. It is 6:30 on Monday, June 8th, and I'm going to call this meeting to order. All rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I will take a motion for approving the agenda.
I'll make a motion to set the agenda as printed.
Second.
A motion by Lee, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. We don't have any public comment this evening, and so nor do we have a superintendent update, so we will go on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is an agenda made up of routine business items that can be acted upon in one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and it will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item that they wish to discuss? Hearing none, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the above consent agenda.
Second.
I have a motion by Cordes, second by Lee. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, then we are on to our first work session discussion topic. It's our calendar revision for the 15-16 school year, and Ms. Barb Dufferin.
Okay, good evening, board members, Chair Singwald, Superintendent Haugen. I have to begin with the 15-16 revision. Is that what's first on the agenda? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I know they go in order. And so for the 15-16 calendar, we currently have in front of you four proposed dates for flexible learning days. You recall in the last budget setting, we had talked about having four flexible learning days proposed. Through our meet and confer teacher and board and administrative group, we picked four days that we're recommending. We looked at days that could be put together with other extended weekends, or to make it a long weekend as opposed to like a Wednesday for the convenience of parents for planning purposes. We also looked at putting one of our days on that April 22nd. The reason that is there is so that if it is the case that we have school closings in the winter, we could potentially make that a school day. So we would have a flexible learning day on a different day during the winter. And then we would reserve that as a day that we could potentially bring the students in. And so I believe those are the main points about those four proposed days.
Madam Chair? So I was thinking that April 2nd was probably the, is it the ACT that they have to take day? So is that also a flexible learning day for the other grades than the juniors that take the test?
Will you say that again? Because I'm not sure which day you're talking.
So like this year on April 28th, all the juniors had to take the, was it the ACT or SAT? I
can't remember. ACT.
ACT.
Mm-hmm. And that was a flexible learning day for the other high school grades.
Sure.
So I was thinking that maybe this was the April 22nd was the day that was going to happen this year, but that wasn't what the thinking
that
was.
That wasn't
there, right?
What the thinking was for that. My thought is that it probably, I'd be surprised if the ACT was scheduled on a Friday. Was it scheduled this year on a Friday? I'd be surprised. That's not typical for a test to be on a Friday. Just we tend to put those important days into the middle for those reasons.
I guess I was thinking it was on a Friday this year, but maybe I mixed up.
I thought it was a Monday, actually.
Yeah, it was early to midweek.
I'm pretty confident because
I think you know you might be.
It was Tuesday.
I was there for choir rehearsal.
Yeah. Oh.
I think somebody had given me.
Oh, good,
me the wrong
you're here
date.
For us. It was
yeah.
a Tuesday.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
There it is.
Somebody had told me the wrong date. I think at one point, and it was the date they gave me was the Friday, so I had that in my head. I think, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
If you could help clarify the process, has this gone through meet and confer so the teachers are okay with the schedule? Correct.
There's been a lot of discussion, yes, and I think that as far as the schedule, they were, I think there was less discussion that was around the actual days, but what the purpose of those days were. So I, correct me if I'm wrong for the others that were there, but I think that was the primary discussion from the teaching mm-hmm. group was how they would utilize those days and how they'd be structured.
But it came back to several meetings, and
yes.
their biggest concern was that the board would make the decision so that they would know for sure,
right.
so that they
right.
could start to communicate it out. that was really...
And I appreciate that you mentioned, you just mentioned those things too. I should point out that we have had quite a bit of conversation about how those flexible learning days have been could be structured mm-hmm. when we can plan for them. So we do have feedback that we get from families during that Meadowview day. Now, that wasn't planned, but we got feedback for the younger students during that time. How do we make a K-2 experience more successful? What's a reasonable amount of time for students to be working in a self-directed, you know, how were the assignments that were, or the activities that went home? So we got that kind of information back at Meadowview. And then we also had a planned flexible learning day for the middle schools in Gateway. And so we do have some experience with a planned day and how that can be different. And so we have talked about with those planned days having structured office hour times so that parents knew exactly and students knew exactly when teachers would be available so that they could get that response quickly. They also talked about from the middle school that a number of students had completed their work ahead of time. So they, because it was whenever they could get it done, they got it done on the weekend ahead of time. And so, but it was also the case that the teachers knew that students weren't going to be there. So there was a lot more set up to make those successful. And so it is a different situation in a lot of ways than the flexible learning days that we've had previously.
Madam Chair, I have a quick question. Mm-hmm. For the office time for the teachers, how long is that per day for flex?
We set aside an hour and a half at this point, is what we've talked about, having an hour and a half of structure of time when they would be dedicated to being there to interact.
And then throughout the day, the kids can email and the expectations for teachers to respond, or?
Well, the idea was so that they would be doing those office hours for that hour and a half to do those responses during that time. So they'd be responding to emails, they'd be interacting with students, you know, they could be calling, they could be talking on the phone, whatever it may be. And then the time before and after that would be some structured time around some professional development.
Is an hour and a half, is that enough time for?
Our middle school said it was, with no problem whatsoever. They said it was plenty of time. It is the case that we talked about that a little bit too, and would it be the case that maybe for our elementary students, maybe it would be 2 hours. But again, because it's planned ahead, and families and students know what to expect, it's just a different experience in terms of needing a lot of questions answered during that time. But
okay.
Madam Chair?
Yeah.
So previously we would have had, you know, so many learning days, in-school learning days, and professional development days. So now we're cutting back, is it 4 days, and that are turning into, are those additional professional learning days for the teachers?
They will be additional learning time, yes, professional time for the teachers. Because part of it will be interacting with students and part of it will be professional.
Mm-hmm. Contracted X number of days with the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So that was our four days of contact time
with 4 days of professional development time.
Right, and that was the discussion, was where's the dollar savings? And the dollar mm-hmm. savings was in busing.
Transportation, mm-hmm. right. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
And some EA time as well.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Madam Chair.
Yeah.
In regards to the procedure around the actual flexible learning days, will there be a time period where assignments need to be up that will be kind of set standard? Because I know the feedback I was getting from parents was some had their assignments up a week beforehand, others didn't get them until, you know,
that morning.
The day of. Mm-hmm. And so for those that might, especially for planning a weekend, if
right.
there can be some sort of, I would, you know, I'm not going to arbitrarily pick a number of days, but X amount of days mm-hmm. beforehand so that the students,
are you talking about
families,
with the middle school days, or are you talking right. about elementary?
Well, I think any of them. I think
well, they're
they
different. Well, they are different because the elementaries that we've had so far have all been emergency. None of them have been planned, and the middle schools were the only planned ones that we had, except for high school. I'm sorry. So high school ACT day was also planned. And so, yes, we've always – the reason I asked is because we have had expectations for that. Mm-hmm. The difference has been –
I was hearing mixed feedback from parents that did have that did not see –
So at the elementary level, I know it's been, when it's an emergency, we've learned a few things along the way in terms of making sure, and certainly with the middle school and Gateway ones we did as well, about making sure things are certain time, though I'm surprised to hear that, but I can certainly.
Well, I mean more like 5 days or something. There'd be a standard that so many days beforehand, especially when we're looking at these look like 3-day weekends or even 4-day weekends. I could see some parents capitalizing on that
I think what you might find is that teachers who are going about it as that continuation are waiting until they're done on that day before the flexible learning day and say, this is how far I got, here's what you're going to continue.
Go ahead, because I'm going to be right behind you.
I understand the point of continuing the school day, but I also think that there can be extra or an additional that can still tie into the unit they're doing, but not maybe specifically what they're doing the day-to-day that would still be applicable, because I think it's just to honor the family's time.
Okay, so let me ask, I'm gonna pause and ask a question, because I guess what I'm hearing right now is an alternate to what we had before, because what we were concerned about was that the teachers were just giving the kids busy work. I mean, that was something that we've hammered the administration about, making sure that we were not just giving homework, busy work to these students, that it was something that was going to extend the learning, mm-hmm. it's to continue the learning. And I get being respectful for families, mm-hmm. but this is no different than somebody scheduling a vacation during a regular school week and yanking their kids. They have to ask for the information ahead of time and all of that. I think setting parameters is important.
But I think it's important, too, that teachers plan. I mean, my son was out for 3 days this year. He didn't get one assignment ahead of time out of all his middle school 7 classes. Not one assignment did he get in advance for 3 days.
Honestly.
And so, to me, you know, are teachers not planning that far? I mean, I just don't understand what the point of getting the whole permission slip was to do that. And here again, you should be able to know 2 days ahead where you're going to be at. So if you had a couple days, because the same thing, my son had assignments that were given to him the morning of that middle school flexible learning day. And some of them were given to him 2 weeks in advance. So you can kind of tell the planners from the people who are, you know, just kind of taking it easy. Okay, here's where I'm at. Here's your assignment today. And I think, you know, if we're going to be using substitutes to, not using substitutes and using the online learning, teachers are going to have to be prepared at least a day or two out, you know. And I guess that is a concern I have as well. And it's not even, like you say, so much as, you know, getting into the family time as being prepared for that day, because the parents may not be able to dedicate the time to coach their kids through that because of their own personal things. So if the teacher can at least give that assignment out a couple days ahead of time, that allows the family to say, hey, I have time to, you know, because what if the parents were going to be out of town but the kid's going to be, you know, it's not that they're pulling the kid out. I mean, I've had that situation too where, you know, the kid gets a project, I don't have time to do the project because it wasn't on my calendar, kind of a thing.
And Madam Chair,
we are all very passionate. Member Lee called it out. I'll let her speak, and then Board Member Carrero can go next.
So I would like to make just a couple of points. First of all, the very first time we ever talked about having a flexible learning day for emergency snow days, we talked about how this was a brand new thing and that we were learning as we go. We have had several now. Some plan, some emergency, and every single time we continue to collect data and talk about how we can get better. And Principal Edwards collected it from the last Meadowview emergency one, and the middle school ones collected what went well and what didn't go well and shared it with our teachers at Meet and Confer. I was there for that. They did a parent survey at Meadowview, correct?
At Meadowview.
Yes.
The middle schools.
And asked, the point is that every time we've done this, we've talked about what went well and what didn't go well and how we're gonna continue to get better, and that it's a process. And that was the main conversation with the teachers and Meet and Confers, how can we make these days productive? As a board, we've talked about not wanting it to be busy work that we're just assigning for a free day, but to be continuous learning for those students. We've also discussed how we use these as different days because they're not a replacement for students in front of a teacher. So what can we do to utilize them differently? So we've had all these conversations. But the second point I want to make is We are having different standards for these because teachers do their classrooms differently based on their grade level, their personality, their content, how far they got. You know, when you are a secondary teacher, you have several different periods, and you may end here in one period and here in a different and here in a different because it depends on the conversation. It depends on what's happening in the classroom. It depends on how engaged the students are. You don't end each period in the same place when you're the same teacher teaching the same subject. So I think it is an unfair standard to suddenly say that every teacher has to end in the same place for a flex day when we don't hold them to that standard in their day-to-day business. And I think that they're having all of these conversations that we're concerned about. I can hear them having these conversations in the buildings and in central office and at Meet and Confer. They're concerned about the same things that we're talking about here. And I feel like we've got to give them an opportunity to take these 4 days that we approved as a budgetary savings and make them be the best 4 days they can possibly be. Because this is something we're asking them to do in order to save money for our district. This is not something they are asking us to do. We're asking them to do this.
Board Member Carroll.
And I don't disagree, but we need to set expectations. Just like with grades, expectations are for teachers to post grades. It's a nightmare that still doesn't happen consistently. I can see this one falling through the cracks too. I think as a district, it's a good plan, but we need to set the expectations. At this time, this has to be out because the kids are looking for it and the parents are looking for it. And there's if they're already scheduled.
This meaning what the expectation for the day is going to be or the assignments?
The expectation of the assignment. By 10 a.m., they're going to have it out and it's going to be posted out there and it's not going to change. So I think that's a clear expectation we can set for the teachers out there.
Madam Chair, if I can add, by no way am I advocating for busy work and just something to do that day. I think there can be meaningful assessments and assignments that are assigned in context of what they're learning. And I do understand that every classroom is different on a day-to-day basis, and I'm not saying that they need to know what they're doing every single day, because I know our teachers are doing the best that they can to do what they need to meet their needs that day with whatever the lesson is. But I also think we need to have a standard back and forth. In the past, when we did have the planned days, the feedback I had was that it was just all over the board and it was difficult for some families to manage. And I'm just asking for somewhere where we can meet the families and the teachers in the middle and make it work that's reasonable for both parties. That's all I'm asking for. I'm not saying that we have to have a set day, but just have some sort of a reasonable standard of expectation for all parties involved. That's meaningful.
And I agree with you. And I think as board members, we all have had our I too have had experiences, my children in the district, some positive, some not so great. But I truly believe our role as a board is not to take that feedback from the people and say, we're going to take care of it, because we know that's not our role. We need to say, if we have an issue with our own children or if somebody, a community member, rather than being the vehicle for I'll take care of it, we should be directing those people back to that person's teacher, to that person's principal, to Barb Dufferin. Because right now, I feel like we've had this, we've asked for it, and as much as I'd like to say we're going to not go with a flexible learning day, because I think having the teachers in front of the students is definitely best. Somebody who's prepared ahead of time, but obviously every teacher in this district is not going to be the same. And so I think that rather than pointing out the single or maybe a couple things that are frustrating, it's going to happen in this district, that we need to go through the right mechanisms to fix that. And so if we hear of something, here, let me get you the contact information.
Absolutely.
I totally agree. We can share that with the administration that we hear this, but I don't think we should be sitting here making decisions based on a couple of, either an individual or a couple of people that reach out to us. I think that it's very important for them to go back. And if we get a more formal, you know, process with the flexible learning days, I think we can make some recommendations to say we've got four now scheduled for sure next year. How do we determine feedback after those days so that we're getting?
Mm-hmm. And I would say that we have not collected data, but I think on two occasions, what I would call data. We have collected anecdotal information. And I've asked before, why don't we, after every single flexible learning day, do a survey, to send a survey out to parents so you actually have data, not, you know, I mean, from a broad cross-section. So I would encourage the district to to do a survey after every one and get, so you get, you know, a cross-section of data, not just this anecdotal information, because you're either only hearing from the complainers or the people that were really, you know, pleasantly surprised how it went. You're not maybe hearing some of the information from that middle ground area that, well, six of the seven classes went really well, but one didn't go, went horrible, and I'm not going to complain because it was only one or whatever. So I think we do need to collect data on this and make sure that we're doing what's right for the students.
Madam
and
Chair.
The other thing I guess I'd say too is that, you know, I don't think it's unreasonable to ask teachers to be, you know, a couple days out. Even, you know, like I say, you have situations where your classes are going at different paces or whatever, but if we're going to hire, if we're not going to hire substitutes and have people walk into these classes and take them over, they need to know what to do with these students. And so, you know, what you were saying about classes ending at different, that doesn't help if they're out sick. You know, so there's got to be some planning there. Otherwise, that substitute cost savings is going to be worthless days for students.
Primarily.
And I do think that, you know, that's a board level request, is to request data after flex learning days. I don't think it's a board level thing to say this is how you need to have expectations on teachers. That's not our job. And so I think it's great to have a survey or data or something like that after flex learning days to continue to learn in a more uniform manner. But I mean, some of this other part is just not.
We're in the weeds.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, hopefully the administration hears that we would like to have a little bit of planning on that, those days.
Thanks. And I just wanted to echo that, or make sure you hear from us that we appreciate that feedback. And, you know, we will certainly do that, you know, collect that kind of data. And, you know, this all just kind of sharpens what we want. You know, these are the kind of things that we brought to meet and confer and work with our teachers on as well. And, concerns we've heard, so thank you.
And isn't there an expectations document that's being put together?
There is an expectations document that exists, yes. So I am going to say, though, that because I would like you to hear it from us, too, that it is the case that we are going to have some staff that are going to give the assignment the day before the flexible learning day weekend begins, and there'll be some others that'll have it much further in advance, and that'll depend on the assignment that's given for the flexible learning day. So, for example, if you're a teacher who has more paper, if you have a paper that perhaps you're working on or a research project that you're working on, it is reasonable to have something way in advance because that's an ongoing project. However, if you are perhaps maybe a math teacher perhaps, and you know that you anticipate that this is where we're going to be by this point, it is the case that you would wait until you are done with that class. And so we are going to have teachers who are at different places, and it's not because they don't plan. It's because that they use where they are, they use their formative assessment data, whatever it may be, to pace it. So it is the case that our expectation is that they would give students and what they're going to be working on before they leave for that flexible learning day, but it wouldn't be that it would be way in advance. We've also talked about the case that in our document, it also indicates that it's flexible. So if it is the case that we have families that couldn't, who struggled with it, or there were some other issues, or they were gone for the weekend, it's always the case that we extend that time. And so that's written right into our document as well.
And to add to that, that was something that was an extensive discussion in meet and confer, was that especially at the elementary level, was to make sure that what they were giving the students was following and extending the learning, but also in a sense that it was flexible enough that those parents had potentially multiple days to be able to get whatever it was assigned completed and back in.
Because, including some choice as well.
Right.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Are there any questions? All right. Well, then we will move on to a review of the 16-17 calendar.
So the 16-17 calendar also has a couple flexible learning days in there. As in this draft, we had two, and they are placed again next to a weekend. One is on a Monday and one is on a Friday, with the intent of having those days be opportunities for staff to use data around. So October 10th would be, we could use some of our map data for planning purposes, so the staff could have some time to use NWEA data. And then February 17th after the elementary mid-year assessments. And so that's why they were placed the way they were. Also, we also have a mid-year NWEA for our students who are in intervention. So those two are the only thing that is maybe a little different from calendars previously. September 6th start day, and June 8th, the last day for staff. June 8th, last day for staff. We also have the assessment days in this calendar as well that we've had previously. So the elementary goes ends 2 days early because they have the assessment days prior to the first day of school. Without going through each part, because it's very similar to calendars we've had in the past. So, if you have any questions.
Are there any questions?
All right. Thank you. Right. On to our third topic, a review of the proposed 15-16 budget, and Ms. Jane Huska.
Madam Chair, Board Members, Superintendent Haugen, members of the community, thanks for having me here tonight. I'm here to discuss the preliminary budget for the 15-16 school year. But before I get going on that, I'd just like to give you a brief overview of what's been happening at the Capitol over the last week or so. Maybe you've heard that the governor, the House and Senate leaders have come to an agreement. And they have settled on $525 million, which is $125 million more than the bill that the governor vetoed. Though the governor did have to concede his pre-K program in order to get the deal done. The date has not been set when they're going to pull the full House and Senate together to vote on the bill, so we're not quite sure when it'll all take into effect. But I thought I'd just hit on some high notes that were included in the bill. There is a 2% increase for the 15-16 and the 16-17 school year. There is some facility funding that is in the bill that would begin in 2017. And there's some increased funding for special ed and extended time. And the one caveat to this whole bill, which I'm sure a lot of schools are having fun with, is that they put in there that school can start September 1st for the 15-16 school year only. So I know, I just want to make you aware of it. I don't think it works well for us, but I know already I've had other colleagues calling and wondering what we're going to do. And we have a unique situation here, I think, in Farmington. But it's interesting to hear their side on what the teachers want, what the school board wants.
So is the Minnesota High School League going to change their schedule then? Because they have tryout. I mean, their 3 weeks is including that week.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought it was very interesting that they threw. And I'm sure there's going to be other caveats as the more details come out about the bill. But those were just the main high points that they threw out for us all to be looking at. So I just thought I'd give you a brief little overview of that information. So on to the big event for the night, to look at the preliminary budget for the 15-16 school year. We will be talking about the general fund, which will include transportation and capital. We'll talk about food service, our community education fund, and our debt service fund. The first fund that we're going to be talking about is our general fund. And as we were building the budget, we based it on the budget framework that was approved by the board in February. And it also took into consideration the adjustments that the board approved in March. Revenue is based on a 1%, which is roughly $450,000, because at the time when I was building, or we were building the budget, we didn't know what was happening at the Capitol. So we just wanted to go with what we had been going with along this whole process. enrollment was based on our projections that we used with our February 1 numbers. And as we look at the budget, it is a balanced budget for the 15-16 school year. So the first thing that we can do is we can turn to page 6, which describes the revenue. And the first thing that you will notice is that our property taxes will be increasing by roughly $935,000. Please note that roughly $600,000 of that has to do with the decision that we made in December to include our OPEB levy on our taxes for this year. The other $300,000 roughly has to do with changes in legislation and our increased enrollment. Our state sources, our state revenue, increased by $702,000, and the two factors that lead to that are the 1% increase in revenue and then our increase in our enrollment. So we do have projecting a revenue of roughly $64 million for the 15-16 school year. As we go to page 7, it is no surprise, or hopefully no surprise, to us or any other district that our main increase for a school district falls under our salaries and wages. Usually benefits fall right in line with that, but we had a little unique situation there that I will talk about that explain that. The other purchase services, supplies, equipment, other expenditures, it's pretty stagnant. We really didn't have any huge increases or decreases. And in those areas, the actual budget managers kind of have some discretion where they actually place the fund. And that usually is the discrepancy between one year and the next, depending upon the needs in their building. So as we look at salaries on page 9, the first thing that I'd like to point to your attention is under the Office of the Superintendent, you'll see a reduction of roughly $120,000. And that is due to the reduction of the position that we had in the Office of the Superintendent. As we move down the line, you'll see $1 million in elementary general. And that has to do, we do have some, as I was running through all of that information today, we do have a couple of coding issues that we need to move out. And it's just a flip-flop. The bottom line will stay the same, but we have some gifted and talented people in there that really should be moved down to gifted and talented and whatnot. And the other increase is Gateway is included in there, and we already have allocated some of the superintendent's FTE. And one other thing that I forgot to note to you is that we did include in here contracts that are settled and unsettled. So there's increases for them as well. As we keep moving down, our secondary has a reduction, and that has is due to, again, we have some code corrections that will fix that. It also has to do with our subs, our reductions in subs there, and different programming that we're looking at our secondary level. As we continue to move down, you'll see a flip-flop between technology and facts, and that has to do with last year tech ed was included in our facts number when they should have been included in technology. So that was just most of the stuff has to do with just coding issues that we're finding and trying to fix. Boys and girls athletics, again, we had some attrition there. More senior coaches moving out, new ones moving in. That's part of our budget adjustment that we had in March as well. And again, we also had an administrator coded in there, and we moved him to the proper place. So that was the discrepancy there. As we move to benefits, you may wonder why we're only at 0.55. As most of you know, health insurance usually is, you know, 8 to 10% on an annual basis. When we built the budget last year, we built it based on enrollment in March or April. Our open enrollment for our district actually closes in May. We did not make an adjustment for those open enrollment changes, because usually it's minor. It's not a big deal. You have the same amount of people going from one plan to the other, and it's not an issue. Well, we had a huge flux in our health insurance. We had many people that were double covered that dropped coverage, and we had almost 200 people move to Plan C. And so that is a big swing when you're looking at costs. So when you're looking at those employees that were discovered because, you know, that's savings right to our pocket, and then a lot of people move to Plan C. So even though we made those adjustments to our benefits this year, so that's why it's only reflecting a 0.55 increase, because we're taking advantage of those changes that we had that we didn't last year. As we move to purchase services, we want to be looking at elementary. There's a reduction of $300,000. Some of that variance, again, will come from the budget manager's decision on where the money needs to be sent, but also it has to deal with all-day kindergarten. You know, we're in our second year. We don't need to put as much money in there, and so it's that fluctuation in there as well. As we continue down, the other big item for purchase services is student transportation. Currently, we do not have a settled contract with Marshall Line, so I based it on some increases from the past two contracts. The one thing that I would like to note is that our transportation costs could be increasing in the next year or two. I don't know if you're aware or not, but Rosemont Apple Valley received some special legislation to build a transportation facility. And currently Marshall Line does a lot of their routes and our routes of kids that are transported outside of our district. And if they do build this facility and they do buy extra buses for those routes, it could mean the cost could all fall on us instead of sharing it with Rosemount. Don't know for sure, don't know what the dollar amount is, but I just want to kind of plant the seed that in a year or two we could see some increases. Absolutely, we will be looking for other partners, other ways to, you know, piggybacking on other districts for those transportation routes, but we just don't know. As we move on to supplies, capital expenditures, and other expenditures, really nothing great general to note. Again, it's discretionary funds that the budget managers get to use and place where they would like. So as we move on to page 15 to talk about the capital fund, it is a balanced budget with 2.3 coming in revenue and 2.3 coming in expenditures. And in our capital fund, it does include our new Apple lease that the board did approve. Additionally, in there is our health and safety plan. I will be bringing forward that five-year plan on June 22nd, as we need to get that approved and send it off to MDE. So I'll provide more detailed information on that health and safety plan as well. As we continue to move on, we move on to food service, which will be on page 16 and 17. The revenue starts on page 16, and we're looking at having revenues of roughly $3.4 million. In that includes a 10-cent increase for lunches across the board, a 5-cent increase in breakfast. Again, I will be bringing that to the board on June 22nd, as we'll need board approval before we can increase that. But please note, this isn't something that we get to decide. There is a federal calculation that we have to go through, and that calculation tells us what our increase has to be.
So can I ask you a question then?
Sure.
Because I'm aware that there's a couple of districts now that have opted out of the food program, mm-hmm. essentially. Mm-hmm. What happens when a district does that, and mm-hmm. what's the impact?
Yeah, so the main concern with opting out of your food service program is being able to still cover the cost of your free and reduced students, your population. That becomes your biggest challenge in your district. I haven't had an opportunity to talk to Prior Lake Savage, as they're going to be doing it this coming year, and I know the business manager there, but it also, in reading the article, it said if they go up, I don't remember the percent, but if they go above a certain percent on free and reduced, they have to go back mm-hmm. on the program because they just can't afford it. So really, that is the big card in this whole, because it is a lot of money that is subsidized with the free and reduced students.
So not necessarily tonight, but I think that would be interesting for us as a board to know is, what is that break point? Mm-hmm. And where are we sitting as a district? Mm-hmm. Because as some of these things hit the news and some districts are going there.
It would be interesting to see, I mean, these are dollars and include any increases. It would be interesting to see kind of quantities, mm-hmm. to see if after we went on the federal plan that had all those requirements about what you could serve, if our
volume
went down. The mm-hmm. other thing is, I think we talked about when Ms. Anderberg first came, of looking at if our recycling was going up.
Yes, our waste.
Because, the waste.
Yeah, I'd like to see if we could sort of figure out all of those numbers and see where it causes us to land.
If I can just ask a question, Ms. Beam, when you were talking about counts, were you talking about how have our lunch counts been over the last 5 years?
Right.
Or
sales?
Well, not sales, because that would include price increases.
Right.
We want to know, have the number of lunches gone down?
Okay. Lunch counts.
Mm-hmm.
And I can give you off the cuff on that one. I do know this year we have turned 360. Our food program once again is doing rather well. Where kids are starting to eat again, the full school lunch again. I really believe the full muscle chicken breast that we serve on the chicken dippity line has made a big difference, and some other changes that they have made has made a and we can ask them has made a big difference as well from what I am seeing.
My children have accommodated too, because now they know what to bring in and what they'll eat in the line. Instead of bringing the full lunch, they're only bringing half the lunch and eating half the school lunch.
Yeah, I think the recycling would be the other piece, mm-hmm. just because, and I, you know, there's probably a lot of parents like myself that I'm like, you better take that whole lunch because it's cheaper for me.
Exactly.
But, you know, we hate to see them wasting the food, though. You know, I think that's not what the program's meant to be.
But we also hate to see a banana 3 weeks later in the bottom of a backpack.
But, just if they're taking it and if we have increased mm-hmm. cost at all on that. So, sorry.
Do you guys have an opinion on it?
Two different ones over Andrew? Here.
Yeah, I mean, the full price, for, you know what I mean? So, like, if you do the full meal, it's less expensive, but if you only get a slice of pizza, it's more expensive. I mean, there is going to be excess waste. I mean, students don't eat everything that they get, and you're required to get a fruit or vegetable, and sometimes you don't like that fruit or vegetable, but you get it anyway. So, I mean, definitely, I think there would be a reduction of waste if you want that option.
Majority of the people I talk to aren't fans of the lunches, but I think it... And, like, in middle school, like, they were good lunches, and, like, as we've grown up, they've just gotten less and less and less, and oftentimes, like, people find, like, little, like, gross, like, things in their produce and stuff, and obviously that's not something we can control, but then they, like, will post it on social media and just complain, and, like, the lunches are so bad. And
so you think you've seen a decline?
I've seen
it's not just been a constant, no one likes school lunches, it's been a decline.
Yeah, because in middle school we were able to get, like, the huge cookies and, like, the ice cream bars and stuff, and now with this...
So the implementation of the federal rules.
Probably
started high school.
Yeah, so I think it goes along with the whole federal, like, regulations, and, like, mm-hmm. everyone likes to point the finger at Michelle Obama, but... That's what I hear.
Yeah. Thank you.
But looking over time, because I have the feeling elementary to high school in general is a decline in mm-hmm. school lunch anyway, but mm-hmm. Just to look long term.
Madam Chair, the other piece, though we're way off topic at this point, is in terms of we have a health policy, don't we?
A wellness policy.
A wellness policy. Mm-hmm. That dictates some of this, and some of this might not all be federal. So there's a lot of pieces of this puzzle that if we're going to open the shell and dig in, we might want to incorporate that as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, school lunches generally have to follow the federal guidelines, and the wellness policy, that comes more into play when we're looking at the a la carte type items. Mm-hmm. So, but the regular meals that we're serving are federal guidelines, and then the wellness policy will overlay with the a la carte items that we're selling in the cafeteria. So,
all right. Thank you.
Absolutely. As we flip over to the expenditure side, we are looking at $3.2 million in expenditures, and the increase roughly has to do with the increase in production costs as the program. Food costs are going through the roof, which I'm sure most of you realize in your own grocery bill, and so we have the same issue here with our food service program. But we still are looking at increasing our fund balance of $213,000. So we'll keep our fingers crossed on that one. As we move on to community ed, we are on the revenue side, we are looking at bringing in $4.3 million. Again, this doesn't include any of the legislative changes that may be coming down the pike, but it does include the increase in population that the board did approve earlier this year. As we move to the expenditure side, the one thing that is to note that is that facility use is no longer in community ed, and that's really the big change for our community ed program. But please note, I forgot to put it in our general fund. But please be reassured that the facilities is a cost-neutral program. So you're going to see... I know you're laughing. I know. I saw both yours and Steve's face. But currently, how it is being run, until the changes are implemented, which they are currently working on, it is a cost-neutral program. And I will put it in for our June 22nd meeting. I knew you guys would get a kick out of it, so I made sure that we...
Quick question on that. Now, we're supposed to get the facility proposal the next meeting as well of the breakdown of fees, correct? It's supposed to be presented to us?
I believe that they, when in my last notes to the board, was that... Oh, was it? I think that I don't think they're going to have the full thing at the end of June. They're going to have that first step piece of it. Is it? It is August before the final one. So they're starting it.
Well, we're supposed to have a rough draft. Our second meeting in June is what we were told. Yeah, because I mean, when we run numbers, I want to include that and see that.
Run numbers for.
When we look at facilities. You know, to your point, saying being cost neutral, I mean,
absolutely.
That's a huge factor in, for budgeting next year. I'd like to see what that looks like. That's why I was curious if this is for next reading in the meeting, we were supposed to have that.
That's so just, I just want to make sure, help me understand, because we're approving this, the 15-16 budget.
Yep.
And typically the budget cycle then, once that starts, we start with truth and taxation in December of this year going into the budget cycle for the 16-17 school year. So what they're bringing to us in August is going to be a precursor to the 16-17 budget, not the 15-16.
Okay, then that's changed, and I haven't seen that communication because last it was backed up before. And I'll share that with you in an email. So we can talk on the side on that, but I have different dates and time frames on that. So.
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely. As we continue on, the last two areas that I'd like to talk about before I open up for questions is our debt service fund. And that basically is the bond principal and interest payments that we have on our outstanding debt, which it also does include the outstanding debt for our OPEB bonds. In that fund, we are looking at bringing in revenue of $18 million, and we're looking at paying out $18 million for our bond. As on our last one, it's our trust fund revenue, and this is where we actually keep track of those bond dollars that we receive for OPEB and where are we at with those dollars. As you can see, our interest continues to decline as our interest rate is so phenomenal out there that just makes me jump for joy. And but on the
out 800,000,
yeah, I was just gonna say, and then on the opposite end, you know, we're paying out $820,000 every year, and that's just gonna continue to increase for the next 20 years. So, and at that point, the one other comment before I forget, that we will be bringing this back to the board on June 22nd, hopefully. The legislature will have details out for us. I can't promise it. So what I would, at that point, I would like just to be able to approve what we know, and then we'll come back and do an amended budget as soon as we know all the details. It's not the first time, nor it will be the last time, I'm sure, that this will happen. But I just wanted to put that out there. Does anyone have any questions?
Madam Chair?
Mm-hmm.
So on the OPIB levy, you said that we got about $600 in levy revenue, is that correct?
$600,000.
So we show between the debt service and that trust revenue, mm-hmm. we're showing 400 some thousand. Where's the other 200 some thousand?
I'm not following.
Say that again.
So you're getting 600 in property tax revenue.
Okay.
And if I look at the last two schedules.
I gotcha. So when we levied for the OPEB levy, we were not allowed to levy the whole 100% because we had bond dollars. So then we had to do a calculation. There's a little formula out there, and it allows you then to say how much you can levy for and how much will be coming out of your bond debt. And so that split for us, I think, was like a 76-24% split. So that was the amount that we could levy, and then the amount that we could pay out of, that we have to pay out of our OPEB trust.
So we're getting 600 in revenue, but I'm seeing 400 on the schedule. I guess, where's the 200? I'm still not.
Oh, okay. In the debt service fund, that is paying back the bonds. Mm-hmm. That's not paying back, nor is it related to the insurance expenditures that we're paying out for retirees. So that's a whole separate bucket. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. And then as we look at the trust fund, that's where you look at the bond dollars that we received in and our OPEB levy. So you have two parts there. So the debt service is just what we're paying out. That's what we owe because we bonded for it. So it's like your home mortgage. You're just paying the $400,000 every year.
Right. So the revenue in the debt service is $435,000,
$36,000. Mm-hmm.
So that's that part of it.
So, and that doesn't tie to anything else. That does not tie to the trust fund, nor does that tie to our OPEB levy. That's purely paying back the bond.
Okay.
So then in the trust account, we have $800,000 worth of expenditure.
Right.
Okay. And of that $800,000, we are going to be getting in $600,000 from the OPEB levy. Because we couldn't levy the full amount because we have to pay out a certain portion out of it, mm-hmm. out of our trust.
Right, yep.
So that $400,000 is just paying back the debt.
Yep.
And this is paying for the actual insurance for our employees.
Still not understand So the 400 is separate even from the 600?
Yes.
So where's the 600 then?
The $600,000 is the calculation that we were allowed.
Right. I know what it is.
Where in the
budget is the $600,000
in the general
revenue?
Fund. Okay. According to our budget parameters, that needs to go into the general fund, and that's where it gets paid out of.
So do we have 1.4 million then we're paying in expenses?
No. The expense shows up in the trust fund. The revenue will show up in the general fund, and then at the end of the year we do an audit entry to move the money out of the trust fund, the 600,000, into the general fund.
Okay.
And then if there's anything left, we move that back to the trust fund.
Okay. All right. And then so going back to salaries and wages, and I had asked you several questions today, and thank you for getting answers back very quickly. Mm-hmm. We have, I don't remember the dollar amount, but we have a category, when you look at the program detail or whatever it's called, mm-hmm. Under data processing, and you said there were 15 positions in there.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just help me understand what kind of positions those are?
Those are all our technology positions.
Okay.
So that would be anyone in the tech department that is working, and I believe it's also, if I remember, some of our instructional technology people, but let me just pull it up. If I typed in the right password. Here we go. But that's who they are. It's all of our...
I guess I'm just trying to understand. So sure. Is the Andrew in that section, or he's in administration, or...
Right. Andrew's everywhere. No, I'll let you know in 2 seconds.
And I don't need to know names. I'm just trying to understand what kind of positions are in there.
Yep, no, I. So. They are our tech, they're called our technology support technicians, our tech support assistants. There is a clerical staff in there. And that is it.
So they're helping with the kind of technology support type things. If you're having problems, they're helping get up, you know, get the system set up. And
These are like, for example, one person is a server person. One is does all of our support for our softwares that we have. There are three of them that are out in the buildings helping with different type things. And the clerical is the one that supports this tech department as well. So.
Okay. All right. That helps me better understand what that is. Then looking at operations and maintenance. So I realize that that's a lot of the janitorial staff and the ground staff and things like that. And at one point we had done some reorganizing around the managerial or directorial level positions in there. Do we have, how is the kind of that area being managed from the top anymore? Is there a person that manages that area, or is that part of your job? Okay, all right, that's what I wanted to understand. And then in purchase services, the transportation stuff, you had said the contract increases were between 1-something and 3-something, but we're seeing an almost a 9% increase. Is there also increases like in number of students or routes or something that's also driving that up?
Absolutely.
So it's a combination of increase in activity plus an increase in the cost.
Correct.
Okay. Okay. That's all I had.
Anybody else have any questions? All right. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
See you in 2 weeks. All right. On to, hang on. Policy discussion. Thank you. And we've okay. I don't have names on that one. Timed out.
Good evening. I guess I'm first. We have the workload limits for certain special education teachers. Love that title. But anyway, it is the policy that MSBA has put forward. There are already specific limits on certain groups that of students that are maybe more of our severely multiply impaired students who are in resource rooms, and they're there more than, they're in the special ed classroom 60% or more of the day. Those already have caseloads that are put into statute. So this is for those who are less than that, just wanting to make sure that districts take a look at making sure that we are taking into consideration all of the other pieces that a special ed education teacher does. And when we look at caseload limits for our LD teachers, our autism teachers, our EBD teachers who are having their students coming in and out. They may be taking a lot of regular ed classes, but they're also receiving services. They want to make sure that we're giving them enough support so that they can do their job. And so there's some specific things that they want looked at. And so this is just saying make sure you do that at some point. And through our meet and confer group, we did talk about having a group in the fall come together and formalize the process that will take into account the factors that are included in B on the second page of the policy, under the general statement of policy there be in determining workload limits, special education staff, the school district shall take into consideration the following factors: the student contact minutes, evaluation, reevaluation time, indirect services, management of IEPs, travel time, and other services required in the IEP of eligible students. And so that will be looked at in the fall with a group of teachers and administration to kind of come to some agreement as what they should be taking into consideration.
Right, and so just for the rest of the board, the meet and confer conversation was that we would review this policy. If the board approves this policy as is, we would review it in a year after that data is collected. Mm-hmm. So,
are there any questions? Well, okay. I just want to say this may be your very last board meeting with us, I believe, since June 30th is your last day. Yes. So publicly, I'm going to say thank you for the years of support that you've given to the Farmington School District. You've got some big shoes that our newest employee will fill, and I know she'll do great because I know you're working on that handoff, but yes. Just want to say thank you for all what you've done for our district.
Thank you.
Very appreciated.
It's been an honor to work in Farmington for 16 years.
Thank you.
All right, on to school district curriculum and instruction goals.
Okay. And that is 601. So I have notes for myself, but I also want to have this in front of me to make sure I've got everything right here. So 601, the difference here, again, legislative updates is what these are all going to be about. A couple things. So the first one has to do with you'll see in a number of these, you'll see the phrase where applicable or, what's the other phrase I think they use? Not where appropriate, or there's another phrase they use in each of these, and it has to do with our waiver. So whereas with NCLB previously, this is how it's going to be with our waiver, there's going to be some language around that just kind of changes it a little bit to open it up a little bit more. At any rate, when you see performance measures, I think, are the first main change. Defining the achievement gap a little bit differently, so it's not just based on test scores, but also looking at how many of our students who are underrepresented in higher level coursework as well, and talking about that as part of the achievement gap as well, and needing to look at that as part of our world's best workforce. You'll see experimental learning in letter G there, and that has to do with defining coursework as also involving internships, and you've heard, or other things where they're on the job. And then the last one there, you see it's under long-term strategic plan A4. They're part of the legislation also talks about having strategies specifically for our English learners, and then also being able, where practicable, supporting our students in their native language as well. And so those are the changes for 601.
Any questions? All right, we'll move on to curriculum development.
Okay, and so 603, that only change there is that applicable word there in responsibility, section 3, C, number 7, it says meet all applicable requirements. Again, that's because of the waiver.
Any questions? All right, graduation requirements.
So for those of you who are brave enough to wade all the way through 613, it's really very confusing. It's because of the testing changes over the years. And so for different graduating classes, the rules have changed. And so that's why there's so many different layers to this. And I'm going to predict it's going to change again based on what I was reading. So it's difficult, you know, so... So essentially, we have right now it had the addition of, I think the main addition had to do with the ACT. Okay, I won't editorialize. The main addition was for the ACT, and it also had to do with the idea that
for students who hadn't passed the grad requirements, they could take other tests in place of those, the ASVAB, ACT. We've talked about that before. So it's updating that. It also has in here that we could offer some of our credits, so like a science credit, I think it's a chemistry credit that we could offer through some of our CTE courses or econ through CTE also. We don't currently do that, but it does open the door to be allowed to do that. We don't have any courses that for our science credits that are offered through through a CTE course. But it does open the door for us as we create courses that we would be able to do that as long as we are meeting standards in those areas. And I think those are your main changes in terms of content. So,
Madam Chair.
Yes.
More of a comment than a question, but I want to just give credit to our staff for the many presentations we have had, because all of these were mostly statutes that changed in the last legislative year. However, I think you've been able to keep the board abreast of these issues, where glancing through this, it didn't seem like anything too new because we knew it was coming.
Right.
And we've had the information from either the counselors for the testing or whichever piece of these. We've seen this at the board table before. We've actually had this policy change from mm-hmm. MSBA. So I just wanted to thank the staff for keeping us on tap of all the issues.
Sure. Mm-hmm. There's a spelling error section only because the science words jump out at me and chemistry is misspelled. That's
oh, yeah.
So under section 6, item 8, letter B.
I thought MSBA, I don't know about that.
Okay. I'll find it.
I'll point it out if you want later.
Okay, perfect. All right.
Oh.
Minor. Mm-hmm. Any other questions on grad requirements? All right, let's go on to transportation safety.
I'm sure you'll have tons of questions on this one. There is one simple change, and it has to do with cellular service and bus drivers. They have now added language that says, or part of traffic, because somebody must have gotten in trouble that you're in the bus, that I'm stopped at a stoplight, I'm sitting in traffic, I can use my cell phone. So they have now put it in that any time that you're in your bus and you're driving, you cannot use your cell phone.
You should just have a disabling of device in there.
Could
you imagine
scramblers.
What all those students would do?
Wait a minute. Now, some schools are going to wireless on the buses.
The bus drivers probably like the students on their devices.
Yes.
We'll have to write a policy for that because they can disable the cellular and then they'll be on the wireless.
There we go. Any questions regarding this policy? All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, we are at the end of our meeting, and I will take a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting at 7:37.
Second.
Motion by Lee, second by Beam. All in favor?
Aye.
This meeting's adjourned.